put that on the that questionnaire about things that you have to do that they got to pay you more for.
If you do it right.
It's
like spoiler.
It is.
This
least spot. Yeah.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, people are retiring. You're even out of rush.
Good, how are you, man?
Board members,
On voice vote, all in favor say aye, opposed no.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Alright. I have a Pride Month proclamation that I'll read. Find the right one here. Whereas the bicycle is an economical, healthy, convenient, and environmentally sound form of transportation and an excellent tool for recreation and enjoyment of Monroe's scenic beauty, and whereas throughout the month of May, the residents of Monroe and its visitors will experience the joys of bicycling through educational programs, races, community events, charity events, or simply getting out and going for a ride. And whereas Monroe's road and trail system attracts bicyclists each year, providing economic health, transportation, tourism, and scenic benefits, and whereas creating a bicycle-friendly community has been shown to improve citizens' health, well-being, quality of life, growing the economy of Monroe, attracting tourism dollars, improving traffic safety, supporting student learning outcomes, and reducing pollution, congestion, and wear and tear on our streets and roads. And whereas the City of Monroe will be promoting bicycling during the month of May 2017, and whereas the City of Monroe is also promoting bicycle tourism year-round to attract more visitors to enjoy our local restaurants, hotels, retail establishments, and cultural city attractions. And whereas the City of Monroe is also promoting greater public awareness by bicycle operation and safety education in an effort to reduce collisions, injuries, fatalities, and improve health and safety for everyone on the road. And now, therefore, Louis Armstrong, Mayor of the City of Monroe, you hereby proclaim May 17th as Bike Month in Monroe, and he urges all residents to join him in their special observance. Signed, 16th day of May, 2017. Okay. I also have a proclamation of Building Safety Month. Whereas our state, the City of Monroe, is committed to recognizing our growth and strength depends on the safety and economic value of the homes, buildings, and infrastructure that serve our citizens, both in everyday life and in times of natural disaster. And whereas our confidence in the structural integrity of these buildings that make up our community is achieved through the devotion of vigilant guardians, building safety and fire prevention officials, architects, engineers, builders, tradespeople, design professionals, laborers, and others in the construction industry who work year-round to ensure the safe construction of buildings. And whereas these guardians are experts in the built environment to create and implement the highest quality codes to protect us in the buildings where we live, learn, work, worship, play, and whereas our nation benefits economically and technologically from using building codes that are developed by a national voluntary consensus code standards developing organization, our government is able to avoid the high cost of complexity in developing and maintaining these codes, which are the most widely adopted building safety and fire prevention codes in the nation. These modern building codes include safeguards to protect the public from natural disasters such as hurricanes, snowstorms, tornadoes, wildfires, floods, and earthquakes. And whereas each year, in observance of Building Safety Month, Americans are asked to consider the commitment to improve building safety and economic investment at home and in the community, and to acknowledge the essential service provided to all of us by local state building departments, fire prevention bureaus, and federal agencies protecting lives and property. Now, therefore, Louis Armstrong, Mayor of the City of Monroe, do hereby proclaim the month of May 2017 as Building Safety Month. Accordingly, he encourages our citizens to join him in thanking those who are dedicated to keeping our buildings safe. Signed the 16th day of May 2017. E, appearances by the public. Do we have anyone from the public who would like to speak tonight about a topic that appears on the agenda? We invite you to do so at this time. Please stand up to speak. Please identify yourself for the record, and you will have a limit of 3 minutes. Please refrain from making the same comment that someone else has made. This is a time to state a comment for the record and not to ask questions. If you represent an organization or a group, only one member is allowed to speak. Brooke will be our timer. Is there anybody who wishes to speak? Yes.
Hello, Chris Soga, I'm the president of the BID board. On behalf of BID, we kind of took a consensus poll today and yesterday about this project and have come to the conclusion as a group that we ultimately don't think it's a great idea for downtown. There are a number of reasons why we feel that way. I only have 3 minutes, so I won't go into a lot of them. One of the major concerns is parking. We just eliminated the parking ramp downtown, and this parking lot is one of our last few public parking spaces with a lot of public parking available. There's a host of other reasons and concerns. We've voiced them all at previous meetings when we talked about this project before. So I'll cut it short and let other people talk that want to, but ultimately we feel there's a number of reasons why we don't think that the plan as a whole. It sounded like from most of the members there was support for this kind of development, just not in one of our parking lots in the downtown area, because parking is really kind of the heart of our businesses, and that's our livelihood, that's how we all make a living. And we don't think that this is going to be a good thing long term for downtown. We're scared about it. Ultimately, that's it. We're all for growth and development, just in the right places, and it feels like this kind of suits the needs of somebody else and not necessarily the downtown community and the community as a whole. So that's my piece on it. And thank you guys for your consideration.
Thank you. Anybody else? Yes, sir.
Bob Dixon, private, appearing here privately today. I've looked at this, and frankly, I don't know all the details, so if I screw up my facts a little bit, excuse me. What it looks to me is that this project asks for approximately $600,000 to $650,000 city funds plus free land consisting of a parking lot. That lot's probably worth $150,000 as a building site. This is going to put considerable strain on the already stressed TIF district. It also takes away 70 parking spots after we just lost more than 100. I think we're down to 51, where a parking ramp used to have close to 200. You had that 40 units with the original proposal was 1.6 units per spot. They're going to put 40 underground spots, I understand, but you're going to have more increased parking on the streets. This is going to stress parking. More importantly, I think this project will likely be a disincentive to other property owners who own downtown properties to improve their properties. I'm not speaking for myself here. I've developed my building as much as it's going to be developed. I put in two new units upstairs. I probably spent I don't even want to know. I probably shouldn't even tell my wife what I spent upstairs. But I know, and there's others that have done that already, the Kellys, the Ewalds. But there's a lot of people out there who haven't done that. And why? They don't have the resources to do it. And what you're doing here is putting 40 units in at a reduced market rent. It's only going to disincentivize those remaining property owners downtown. And why? Why are we doing that? We're doing it for somebody that's out of town. Why are we not creating a program that will benefit the people that are already here? 25 years ago, I was part of the Monroe Commerce and Industry Foundation, and the first thing I learned is look to retention, not to attraction. Retain the people you already have here. Create a program that's going to help people create all of those beautiful lofts upstairs for rentable properties at a higher than market, the current market price. That'll attract more people downtown. That'll generate snowball into more development. Not create something that could just as well be on the west side or somewhere else and give them money. So take that $650,000, $800,000 that you're giving away today and create a plan. A plan that says, hey, you. And Mr. Sukup can't say that, but create what we already have here by giving it to those people that have invested in downtown already. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else like to speak? Yes.
Dave Cabozzi, former president of the Chamber of Commerce and bid board member. Currently we've got four properties on the square. We're looking to acquire two to three more by the end of the year. And one of the challenges I find right now is that there's already numerous locations on the square that aren't rented as it is. And some of the concerns that I have are that as building owners on the square try to make their buildings safer, more beautiful, and attractive to other people from outside of the community, funds can be challenged in the very near future. As new buildings come in, beautiful new apartments. It does start to take people from the apartments on the square, and of course they want to move to the new beautiful apartments with stainless steel refrigerators, and I understand that. But the challenge becomes then as we as business owners who own the properties start to lack rent. One person leaves to go to the new apartment, a second, a third, a fourth, a fifth. And then all of a sudden what we have is we have a bunch of buildings down on the square that can't sustain themselves, i.e. paint, windows, trim, things of that nature. And if you go through the square right now, some of the buildings are challenged as they are. Some of the backs of the buildings have windows falling out of them. Some of the fronts of the buildings have windows falling out of them. Some of them have no paint on them. And I don't want to see downtown go backwards. I want to see it to go and move forward. And I do truly believe in the program that these gentlemen offer. I truly don't believe it's in the right spot again. We've got locations downtown that we still can't find parking. 40-something parking spaces were taken today where the proposed site is. Where do those people park? We know you've made some improvements on the parking deck downtown or the parking lot. Still believe it should have been a parking deck that's passed and gone, but we're still gonna have a parking problem. I have one tenant right now downtown who's talking about moving off the square. He's been there for quite a while because they can't find parking right now. So something to consider, please be cautious. I'm not thinking about necessarily today what the downtown stores look like, but what's it look like 3 years, 4 years, 5 years down the road when they don't have rentals up on the top sides? And I think that's gonna be a problem that we're gonna see and we see in other communities. So believe in the program, just not in the downtown area. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else? Yes, sir.
My name is Christopher Barth. I am also on the bid board, so there's some conflict with what's been said already. But I'm speaking as a building owner on the south side of the square. And my particular concern here is that this would not be occurring if it weren't for the incentive that we are offering to this company. If we're intent on offering incentives, we've got a much more immediate concern than the parking lot north of the square. We have an empty space in the southeast corner of the square, which has been intractable for a number of years and owned by several different people who know it's impossible, very nearly, to put a new building in a historical district on the square without, you know, some incentive. Do we have any plan for that corner? I think that speaks for itself, so I'm not going to go on much more about it. And what I will talk to is something that has been brought up before, but talking to Chris Sokup a bit earlier, he suggested that you actually do have a program, which I was not aware of, whereby we could, any of us on the square could approach you with a project, and you would do exactly some of the things that Dave Gambosi was talking about and so forth. I'm sure there are a number of building owners who don't know that. If that is true, if someone can answer that for me at some point this evening, I personally will undertake going around to the people on the square who would do something and organize them to come before you. But then keep in mind that would be a request for more money from you folks. So when you're talking about spending money today, keep in mind that I can come to you with a proposal for a fair number of dollars to be used on the square. Pretty short order if you want it. That's all I have to say. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else? Yes.
I'm Terry Getz and I represent the museum and Turner Hall, and as a resident in the area. And having lived another place for a long time and coming back and seeing how alive our square is, that says something terrific. And one reason that we're still alive is that we have had in the past available parking. And I feel that the parking is major, major issue here. And trading the parking, which we need, for another project that addresses another need, we still end up with only one need. So we're trading and we're losing something that I think is too valuable. If a study has shown that this is underutilized, that doesn't mean that it's unused. And I like to look at those excess parking places as a savings account for when we are going to grow and develop and need more things. Our downtown activities are very, very impressive in terms of how many people we bring. This is a vibrant, special, unique downtown area, and everybody should be proud of what's happening on there. But we need parking to sustain that, and I would hate to have that given away. And just because a place is available for a project doesn't mean that it's desirable for that project. I'm having a very hard time thinking about that particular use in that particular place for many reasons. We at the museum are really concerned about what happens to our museum and the activities that we carry on there. This town has donated hundreds of thousands of dollars to improve that museum. The difference that has happened in the last 5 years is phenomenal. I'm sure you've been there and you've seen it. We are working very hard to have a viable museum, but if our guests cannot get there, and most people who go to historic museums are on the historic side themselves, and they need to be able to get into these buildings easily. Taking that parking away is not a good thing for that. So I don't agree with the project in this place. I don't agree with trading one need for another need and only ending up with one. And I feel very, very badly about what will happen to our museum attendants. Thank you.
All right, thank you. Anybody else? All right, moving on.
Are you gonna have a flare right
now? Oh, sorry, yes, thank you.
Okay. This is to members of the City of Monroe Common Council from Stephen R. Elmer. This is regarding the proposed housing project dated May 7th, 2017. Mr. Shanks says that not a single new multi-unit housing project has been built in the last 10 years. Is this proof that a massive high-density apartment complex is needed, or is it proof that other developers have not seen a financial need for additional housing of this type? Monroe may need high-quality, low-income housing, but it does not need a massive, high-density, three-story, multi-unit apartment complex in the middle of an area currently zoned for single-family residential homes. Its proposed location is also inappropriate for an area designated as a historical district. This housing complex would be nearly a mile away from the nearest school or grocery store. It would do nothing to address Monroe's homeless population. Its footprint is so huge that it will take a three-story building all the way to the property boundaries on three sides without leaving any buffer space at all. The entire east side of the building will be so close to the adjacent property that a fire truck, ambulance, or other emergency vehicle couldn't even access that side of the building. The city will lose substantial parking anytime the parking in the downtown area is critical. It will lose ownership of the prime property, which could be used for future parking. I know that the Greene County Historic Society has expressed concerns over a lack of parking for its visitors. In response, there has been a generous offer by the developer to share parking once a month for the Historical Society's board meeting and for the hours that it is open on Friday afternoons. What about other times? How fair is this? Your housing study indicated that studies show that low-income housing doesn't increase crime rates. If you research this issue on your own, you will find other studies which show the opposite, and this issue is far from agreed upon. Public tax dollars were never intended to be used for private developments, and were particularly never meant to be used to help a private for-profit developer gain an unfair advantage over its competition. This developer is asking you to give his corporation $615,000 as well as the substantial value of the land itself. His overall proposal, even if extended to the maximum life of the TIF, isn't projected to totally repay the city for its cost, let alone offer any sort of gain. It also fails to consider the increased cost to the city sewer and water services for 40 apartments, nor does it address the increased cost of law enforcement services. This is a losing proposition for the city even before it is started. What steps has the city taken to assure that these units remain low-income units and that the developer can convert any or all of them to full cost units if long-term costs rise, or if the developer doesn't give his profit margin as what he had hoped for. The developer has indicated that the financial viability of this project will depend on MEDA tax credits and federal grant assistance. What steps will the city take to deal with the possibility of these monies becoming unavailable in the future? Increasing the city's population without first increasing job availability seems to be totally illogical. Shouldn't the need for an apartment complex be driven by a need for additional workers? Where are the existing jobs that will support 40 additional workers? It is wishful thinking to think that increasing the city's population will, by itself, improve job availability or the city's economy.
Thank you. All right, moving on. Consent agenda.
Move to approve.
Second.
All right, hearing the motion and second to approve the consent agenda. Roll call vote.
And you are voting correct, Joe? Newcomer?
Aye.
Cook?
Aye.
Tolman?
Aye.
Marsh?
Aye.
Schilt?
Aye.
Boyce?
Aye.
Baumann?
Aye.
Miller?
Aye.
All right. Comments and questions on Treasurer's Report? No, it's not here. Hearing none.
Okay. Is there any questions for those two?
Public Safety Committee.
Council President, I have a resolution approving special events. Be resolved by the Common Council of City of Monroe upon recommendation of the Public Safety Committee that approval be hereby given for the following special events: American Legion, Zilmer, Riley Post, number 84, to hold the Memorial Day Parade, Memorial Service, May 29, 2017, from 8 a.m. until 10:30 a.m. Offered by the Public Safety Committee, dated the 16th day of May, 2017. I move for its approval.
Second. All right, we have a motion and a second. Any discussion? All right. We have a motion and a second to approve special events by voice vote. All in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Hearing none, motion carries. License Committee.
Your Honorable Counsel, I have a resolution approving a temporary extension of license premises for Leisure Lanes Incorporated to add outdoor beer garden in conjunction with car shows and bean bags. Offered by the License Committee, and I move for approval.
Second. All right, we have a motion and a second. Any discussion? All right, we have a motion and a second to approve the resolution approving temporary extension of the license premises for Leisure Lanes Incorporated to add outdoor beer garden in conjunction with car shows and bean bags. By voice vote, all in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Hearing none, motion carries. Thank you.
Your Honor, Council President, I have a resolution granting a temporary Class B wine license to Monroe Chamber of Commerce and Industry in conjunction with the wine walk at multiple locations. It's offered by the License Committee, and I move for its approval.
Second.
All right, we have a motion and second. Any discussion? Right. Motion is second to approve the resolution granting temporary Class B wine license to Monroe Chamber of Commerce and Industry in conjunction with wine walk and multiple locations. By voice vote, all in favor indicate by saying aye.
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 Opposed? Hearing none, motion carries. Judiciary and Ordinance Review Committee.
I'm President. Of artists reviewing and recreating sections 213.2 and 213.3 of the Monroe City Code, composition of Airport Board of Management. This is Common Council City Monroe, who ordains as follows: Section 1. Section 213.2 of the Monroe City Code is defined as repeal and repeal to read, and as follows: 213.2, members in appointment. The board shall be composed of 7 voting members, which shall be appointed by confirmation by the council and subject to the following. A. 2 members shall be all persons appointed, with one of such all persons given and serving as chairman of the board. B. 2 members shall be citizens. C. 3 members that meet any of the following qualifications: hangar owner or superintendent at Monroe Municipal Airport or an authorized representative of central owner or tenant. An owner or authorized representative of an airport business operating in Monroe Municipal Airport or a person with aviation expertise or knowledge that owns real property located in the city of Monroe. There's no qualified person can be found in the area and appoint any says the terms of each alderman shall be from the time of his or her appointment to Monday beginning the third Tuesday in April of the succeeding year. Initial terms of the main members shall be 2 members for 1 year, 2 members for 2 years, and 1 member for 3 years, ending on the Monday beginning the third Tuesday in April of the succeeding year, a year of acquisition. Thereafter, all on all terms shall be for 3 years. Each member shall take and file the call for official post. Section 2, 15.3 of the Monroe City Code is hereby repealed and declared to read as follows. 2.13.3 meetings. Meetings of the board shall be held at the call of the chairperson and at such other times as the board may determine. The quorum shall consist of 4 members of the board. And section 3 of this ordinance shall be full force of the date following passage and official publication. Move the adoption of this ordinance.
We'll open this up to a public hearing. Does anyone from the public want to comment? Hearing none, back to the council.
Move for its approval.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any discussion? Okay, we have a motion and a second. Ordinance repealing and repealing sections 2-13-2 and 2-13-3 in the Monroe City Code, composition of Airport Board of Management. By roll call of all in favor, who indicate by stating aye, and opposed, no. Clerk will call the roll.
Alderperson Cook?
Aye.
Tolman?
Aye.
Marsh?
Aye.
Schilt?
Aye.
Boyce?
Aye.
Baldwin?
Aye.
Miller?
Aye.
Newcomer?
Aye.
Madam President, I have an ordinance repealing and recreating section 163, front C, 211, 242, 251, 272, 214-1C, 215-2C of the Monroe City Code, Boards and Committees, City Secretarial Duties. It's quite lengthy. I guess that everybody has got a copy of it and been through it. I guess this will be held for public hearing.
All right, we'll open for a public hearing. Does anyone from the public want to comment? Hearing none, back to the council.
Move for its approval.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any discussion?
I guess basically what this is doing is it's cleaning up some of the codes that are talking about secretaries and different committees and stuff, and just cleaning it up and making it a little neater. So that's basically what it's doing.
Thank you. All right, we have a motion and a second. An ordinance repealing and recreating sections 1-6-3.C, 2-1-1, 2-4-2, 2-5-1, 2-7-2, 2-14-1, and 2-15-2, parenthesis of the Monroe City Code, Board of Community Duties. By roll call vote, all in favor will indicate by stating aye. And opposed, no. The clerk will call the roll.
Alderperson Tolman.
Aye.
Marsh?
Aye.
Schilt?
Aye.
Boyce?
Aye.
Bowman?
Aye.
Miller?
Aye.
Newcomer?
Aye.
Cook?
Aye. I have an ordinance for reviewing and recreating section 158E and creating section 158H of the Monroe City Code, Council Rules of Procedure. Common Council of City of Monroe does the ban as follows. Section 158E and Monroe City Code is hereby repealed and recreated to read as follows. E. Motions. When a motion is made and seconded, it shall be in the possession of the Council and shall be stated by the presiding officer or being in writing and shall be delivered to the clerk to be read previous to the debate. After motion is stated by the presiding officer, it shall not be withdrawn except by consent of the Council. When a member is about to speak to a question or make a motion, he or she shall address the presiding officer, and the presiding officer shall pronounce the name of the member entitled to the floor, and the member shall define themselves to the questions under consideration. No member shall speak more than twice on any question for more than 10 minutes at any one time without leave or 3/4 of the members present. The motion to adjourn shall be in order unless the council is engaged in voting and shall be decided without debate. Section 2, Section 1588 of the Monroe City Code is hereby created to read as follows. H, citizens' right to address council. Any citizen shall have a right to speak to the council under the advantage of the public agenda item, provided such citizen registered to the city clerk prior to the meeting, his or her name and address is about to be discussed. Each citizen shall be limited to 5 minutes or unless council agrees to 2/3 vote to extend the time. Any speaker requires an interpreter because of disability or limited English proficiency shall be for 10 minutes. This order shall be enforced on the date of the passage. This will be held for public hearing.
I will open to a public hearing. Does anyone from the public want to comment? All right, hearing none, back to council.
I move to adopt this order.
Second.
All right, we have a motion and a second. Discussion?
Council President, I'd like to make a few comments about this. I feel like this is taking away some of the, well, it is taking away the discussion that we have on topics. Committees are down to 4 people, and we cannot discuss anything there except for 4 people. It comes to City Council, and all we can do is just make our comments. But through the discussion that we have at City Council and committees, we come up with different solutions, and this is going to be narrowing down the representation that we do for 10,000 people in this town. The decision will be made by just a few people discussing it and coming up with a solution. I feel like it's taking away some of the discussion that we have, and we're not being able to fully represent people of Monroe.
Council President Newcomer, I'd like to just mention and remind Alderman Miller that the council can vote to suspend the rules to enable unlimited discussion on any topic when it wants to. So this is more of a housekeeping issue to keep them moving on track when the agenda is full.
Council President, this also does not limit a alder person asking somebody in the audience a question to gain information on the subject of being discussed. It does not change that whatsoever.
Honorable Mayor, I just want to bring out that this is also in accordance with Robert's Rules, which is what we've discussed that we should be following. In Robert's Rule, it talks about speaking twice and time limits are acceptable, so that's good.
Anything else?
I just have a concern about public having to register prior to meeting time just before they say you want to speak to the council. Sometimes people are not in town in time to do that, or they don't have the knowledge of what's going on until it's too late. And I just feel that that's a little bit overboard regulations. I don't really think that's necessary.
We have a motion and a second. Ordinance repealing and creating sections 1-5-8-16 and creating 1-5-8 of Monroe City Code Council Rules of Procedure. A roll call vote. All in favor indicate by stating aye and opposed no. The clerk will call the roll.
President, I did want to bring up here that I would like to see this return to the Judicial Department Committee under Section 2 to review that a little further before we vote on it.
Once you put the question to a vote, it has to be voted on.
So the only thing we can do is vote yes to that.
Alderperson Marsh.
Aye.
Schultz.
Aye.
Boyce?
Aye.
Bowman?
Aye.
Miller?
No.
Newcomer?
Aye.
Cook?
No.
Tillman?
No.
Yeah, here. 5-2-3.
Motion carries.
Ordinance repealing and recreating section 156B and repealing chapter 16 of Title 2 of the Monroe City Code, repeal of information technology committee. This is before the copy before the council members. This will be held for public hearing.
Welcome to the public hearing. Does anyone from the public want to comment? Hearing none, back to the council.
Move for approval.
Second.
We have a motion and a second in discussion.
What this ordinance is doing is just removing commercial technology committees from the list of boards and committees. At this time, all this is good.
Thank you. We have a motion and a second. Ordinance repealing and creating sections 1-5-6 from D and repealing chapter 16 of Title 2 of the Monroe City Code, repealing information technology committee. By roll call vote, all in favor indicate by stating aye and opposed no. Clerk, call the roll.
Alderperson Schultz.
Aye.
Boyce.
Aye.
Baumann.
Aye.
Miller.
Aye.
Newcomer.
Aye.
Cook.
Aye.
Tolman.
Aye.
Marsh.
Aye.
Carries. Finance and Taxation Committee.
Council President, I have a resolution authorizing purchases and designating funding source for squad camera operating system and associated video storage equipment for the police department. Be it resolved by the Common Council of the City of Monroe on recommendation of the Finance and Taxation Committee that approval be hereby given to purchase necessary hardware and software for camera operating systems for squad cars. In addition, approval be hereby given to purchase necessary hardware and software for the storage of video files. The cost for equipment programming installation not to exceed $125,000 to be paid for using previously designated funds identified in the 2016 finance package as Series 2016B, offered by the Finance and Taxation Committee, dated the 16th day of May 2017. I move for its approval.
Second.
All right, we have a motion and a second. Discussion?
I have one question. I thought the amount was lower than 125.
When I talked to Rob, he said that he thought installation, that was like the bare minimum cost for installation. So just wanted to be sure there was enough in there to make sure the installation was covered.
So what was the amount that we approved out of committee?
118,938.
Okay.
Yes.
We have a motion and a second to authorize purchase and designating funding source for squad camera operating systems and associated video storage equipment for the police department. By roll call vote, all in favor indicate by stating aye. Opposed, no. The clerk call the roll.
Alderperson Boyce.
Aye.
Baumann.
Aye.
Miller.
Aye.
Newcomer.
Aye.
Cook.
Aye.
Tolman.
Aye.
Marsh.
Aye.
Schultz.
Aye. Salary and Personnel Committee.
Your Honorable Council President, based on the recommendation by the Salary and Personnel Committee, I would like to make a motion to authorize filling a vacancy created by departure of Assistant Administrator and Director of Community Development Shanks. And the committee has approved the job description that was given to us, which will put more of an emphasis on HR and economic development and kind of see what we get from there and we can make a decision. But the job title itself at this point is Assistant Administrator. And I would move for its approval.
Second.
All right, we have a motion and a second. Any discussion?
What's the pay rate?
15, right?
Is that
rate
the
15, I think it started at 55.
Yeah, somewhere around there.
What was it?
Around 55.
At the entry level, unless there was some, based on qualifications, a different staffing rate on that grade.
We did look at the grades for both an HR and a community development person, and they were right in that same area.
And Alderman, you felt that the job description that was put together by Mr. Rath gives us enough latitude to attract an individual who might possess community development capabilities as well as human resource capabilities. So it casts a pretty wide net.
And I totally agree that the HR.
Yeah, we did as well.
Is this the job description you presented at the last city council?
That was a community development. So we'll forward out the job description for the assistant city administrator. It will have some of those functions, but it's a more of a a general position that can focus on community development or HR, whatever is needed, wherever their skill set is, communication, internal, external as well. So those are the three primary areas.
We definitely need to push economic development, community development. I think that's what our major goal should be on this position. I mean, yes, HR knowledge would be good, but I think we need to get moving, get this town moving. It's been stagnant for too many years, which is going pretty good. And I think we need to keep going on and push harder.
Anybody else? We have a motion and a second to authorize filling the vacancy created by Departure of Assistant Administrator, Director of Community Development, Shanks. Voice vote, all in favor, indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Aye.
Motion carries. Council of Whole, proposal from the Monroe Clinic regarding the creation of tax increment financial district number 10.
Okay, so you had some materials, a little council report, and some associated materials with that. The city has been approached by Monroe Clinic. There's some representatives here tonight. If there are any questions, more specifics about the project. What they're looking at doing is, with their upcoming expansion, the new facility is relocating the laundry services that are going to be vacated with the demolition that is also going on currently, and also adding the possibility of cancer care services to the Monroe campus. They are looking at fronting all of development costs on this. What they're looking for is the incentive on the backside, so as the project increases in value, then they'd look to get an incentive equivalent up to $150,000 per year for 20 years to offset the cost they look to incur for specifically the radiation and hauling services. A lot of equipment and additional cost of the footprint and everything we have to work with the building